There we go. All right, everybody enjoy that?
So much.
Huh?
I enjoyed it so much, Dr. K.
Did you? Are you, good, Chris. I'm going to take that statement literally.
Good. I meant literally.
Good. All right, we're on the same page. No, that's a classic old song from my, I don't know when that song came out. I was probably in my 20s, early 20s. No, I was late teens. So I was late 70s. All right, my friends, let's rock and roll. Let's do the thing. It's election night. Elmo says, burn, baby, apparently. Yeah, okay. We'll try to tell. So, yeah, anyway. Yeah, let's try to tone down the hyper-partisan statements. We definitely don't want to drag that into our happy chat. It's bad enough out there. This is, you know what I mean? Because the reality, Jay, is that, you know, everything could burn one way or the other, and nobody's sinless in this whole gig. That's my take. That's why I voted for... Can't hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, somebody can't hear me. Are you just...
I can hear you too.
All right, Jay, man.
I can hear you.
Jay, you got problems, buddy. Okay, all right. Yeah, no, I think that was the deliberate, maybe that thing. Anyway, I'm just saying, everybody knows how I voted. Been, no, you guys stop it. Seriously. Everybody just...
I'll stop now. I just had to get one in.
Oh, my. Anyway, all right. Look, everybody's dirty, man. Everybody sucks. That's where I'm at. That's where I've been reduced to. I'm pulling up the slides, by the way. But that's my personal political philosophy is now at this point in my life is everybody sucks. I think there's a lot of evidence to support my position.
Even me, Dr. K?
Not until you run for office. Then, for some reason, the suckage just descends. There's no way apparently around that. Everybody eventually sucks. Just put that... Somebody want to make a meme out of that? Everybody eventually sucks. Including me. Especially me, depending on who you ask. Okay, here's where we are. We are in... LC3 goodness, and we did, hang on, you're like, Dr. K, we can't see your slides, like, I know, where are we at, data movement, oh, here we go, yeah, it's the, we're dropping in, man, we're dropping in, we talked about PC relative mode, indirect mode, base plus offset, and immediate, okay? I reminded you that all these terms... Hang on a second. I had to mute my mic before. I don't know what happened. I seized up. It was all the... Okay, is that a real quote from Batman, Mike? You either die not sucking or you live long enough to suck. That's Batman's corollary to Dr. K's assertion that everybody eventually sucks.
It's a rough paraphrase.
Okay, all right. So we talked about these four different ways, right, of figuring out where to get stuff. And this is the important thing, okay? This is the really important thing about, like, why... Why is this a thing? Right, look, just give me what I need, right? Give me the stuff I'm looking for. The problem is that there are just a lot of reasons, a lot of things you do in practice when you're trying to write software about, you know, how to get what you get. And some of it makes perfect sense. And really, it's all just an extension of real life, right? I've either got it right here with me, the thing I'm looking for, or I've got to go somewhere to get it and I tell you where to go to get it, or I know a guy and you got to go to that guy and he's going to tell you where to get it, you know, and that's in direction, you know, it's just, there are just different ways, you know, to make your way around. They really are sort of analogous to real life. If you just kind of look at it for a second, we did PC relative, and then what we skipped over was indirect, right? And then we went to immediate and to base plus offset. Remember that? Remember how well you remember that? And what we're going to do today is talk about the indirect mode. because it was just a little clunky enough and we kind of ran out of time, we're going to wrap this up. So I don't know if we got Zach on. Zach's normally on. There you are. Yeah, and Zach and Vlad are on. And so due date should start on, what is this, Zach? Module 6? It's lecture 5, yes. Module 6. I don't like my numbering scheme, by the way. And you're like, well, why don't you change it? And the answer is because I suck. That's why. It's on my to-do list. Right after running for Congress. And by the way, yeah, we should talk about that at some point. These are the instructions.
You're running for Congress?
No, but we should talk about it. That's all I'm saying.
About your plan to run for Congress?
Yeah. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? It's not right now, but like, you know, whether I should. And if so, you know, what's my platform? And as a disgraced former Republican, can I run for office in the state of Utah and win? Highly unlikely.
Oh, not a
chance. I'm not really disgraced. Okay. LDI and STI. Let's go. Come on. We can do this. Anyone else like having like weird election day anxiety like me? I'm just like, I can't focus on anything. I'm just like,
I'm very much in the
yes, same. Get it over yeah. with. Can we just, you know what I mean? I'm just like standing there waiting to get punched in the face and kicked in the crotch or something. Just like, come on, just get it over with. And the best part is, okay, I posted. I'm with you there, Jay. Thanks Zach for the support. I posted just now, before class. I posted this on Facebook. I said, if either Biden or Trump wins the presidency tonight, I'm going to leave the country. This is not political. I just really need to travel. That is what I posted.
Understandable.
I know, right? That's kind of where I'm at. Because really, I need to get out. I need to just go somewhere. And COVID has also been like cramping my style for way too long. Way too long. All of us. Okay, enough. That's group therapy. Okay, let's move on. I think we've made a lot of good progress here this week. Here's the punchline for indirect. I'm going to give you a location, and in that location is going to be the address of where you can go find the real thing. Okay? That's the kind of the fundamental punchline, and I'll kind of walk you through it. So once again, you've got LDI and STI. Load is loading, right? You're taking stuff out of memory into the register. Storing is you're taking the contents of your register, pushing it out. What?
Sorry. I didn't
mute, mute your mic, sir.
My bad.
We shall not be... what's the word I'm looking for? Tittering. I think that's actually a word. Okay. There's the opcodes, destination or source. And the indirect mode for the LC3 is done with the PC offset. And in particular, 9 bits of PC offset. And we talked a lot about how we do that. Okay. All right. Wow. Hang on. What happened? Wow. Oh, did I like, hang on everybody. This is just fantastic. I'm now streaming I accidentally hit a key, a rando key, which I don't even know what it was, and apparently mirrored my screens. That is fantastic. And now I'm like, okay, how to flip it back? Isn't this great? Can you guys hear me still?
Yes.
What if we go?
The only thing we can see in the live stream, or at least for me, is the bottom left corner of what was being displayed.
Oh, really? So you don't see...
Mostly it shows I vomited.
That's a good message, though.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I see.
That's a solid... Okay. Well, that's not what I see. Okay, hold tight, hold tight. I apologize. Like, some kind of a... It's like Grandpa's gone nuts on the laptop, you know? Like, Grandpa, stop it. Yeah, I mean, like, I don't know. Is there a hotkey to mirror this? There must be a hotkey to mirror the displays that you can just accidentally bump. We're back to golden, right?
Yep. Yeah, it looks good. Right.
I don't, seriously, I was just like, flippity flip, you know, and I don't know. Thank you. I'd like to thank Apple engineers. Without whom this moment would not have been possible. All right. Here we go. Are you ready for this? I know you're excited. Oh, I'm sorry. It's so hard to care. It's just so hard to care. I feel the same way about, like, you know, like a national championship football game when you care at some level. Only this is like way less of the right kind of energy. This is more just like this foreboding sense of doom, and I am nonpartisan in my feelings of doom. Because I know Kanye's not going to win, you know, despite my support.
Don't say that. He's got a chance.
He has a message that fills people with hope. That's why he's going to win. Okay, here we go. Ready? Ready. We're going to get through this. I'm going to muscle through. All right, here we go. So we've got the instruction register. This is the instruction right there. That's the LDI opcode. That says that the, so load means I'm going to load, I'm going to load from memory into my register. So that's the destination register. That's the PC offset. Okay. Hex number 1CCC. You might note that this is a negative number, right? It's negative, which means we're going to, you know, grab stuff from ahead of us. Here it is in the instruction register. And that's going to go, those 9 bits are going to drop into here. We're going to sine extend it to 16, which turns it into FFCC. Remember, sine extend, you take that, whatever the sine bit is, and you add more of that sine bit, right? Meanwhile, we take the PC, and what do we know about the PC? What's the little tidbit to always remember about the PC at this point in the operation? Anybody? Bueller? I'm going to wait. Come on, Bueller. Okay, I'm not going to wait for Bueller. It's already, thank you, Jacob. It's already been incremented, right? It is the incremented program counter. It's already been incremented. So, excuse me. So that's the program counter. It just happens to be the location one after the location in memory that we happen to be, you know, executing that instruction. We take that value, and we just add them together, straight up. And once again, just as a reminder, that guy's a negative number. What do you do when you're trying to add a negative number? Nothing. The number, the negative is already encoded. The magic of 2's complement, take any 2 numbers, and you just add them together. That's all, you know, you're good. So you add these together. And the result goes into the memory address register. So remember before we would like take that result and put it into the register directly or, you know, something like that. Here we put it into the MAR. Yeah. Okay. So when you take that guy, which is 4A1C, you add these 2 together and you get a smaller number because that guy's negative. Okay. Now what we're going to do is we're going to drop in to this part. Here it comes into the MAR. This is just like a representation of memory, just random memory in the LC3. These are memory addresses. Just again, you know, random, the dot, 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 the little vertical ellipses are kind of trying to suggest. There's, you know, here's some examples. then there's some gap, and then there's some more examples, right? And but there's just 16 bits in every location in memory. So we put that into the MAR, which points to that location. We take that value, and we put that in the MDR, okay? Now, you're probably thinking, hey, we're good to go, right? I mean, you gave me the address. I went to that location in memory, and I grabbed it. But that's not what indirect is. Indirect says, go to that address in memory, and when you get there, that's not it. You got to grab that value out of memory, treat that like an address, and then go there. It's a little bit like I give you a treasure map, right? And you're hunting around the treasure map. You find the X marks the spot. You're digging, and you dig, and you find the little chest. You take the chest up, and then you look in it, and what's inside? Anybody? Bueller?
Bones.
No bones.
Another map.
Another map. Thank you. Another map. So I grab that. Now I got to go follow that journey. You know, it's like, whatever. National Treasure. What was that movie with Nicolas Cage? The best Nicolas Cage movie of all time. That's not a real high bar. Anyway. All right. So we take that value we pulled out of memory. Here, let me back it up. We take this value, right? It's in the MDR. Only now, boom, we just move the contents of the MDR over into the MAR, which is that value, you know, 2110. And then now that points here. Grab that guy, pull it out. It just happens to be -1. Put that into the MDR. Boom, now that's what we were actually looking for. Okay? And now there comes FFFF, which, hang on, we can now put into the destination register. Okay? Now, I want to just talk for a second. So it is a little more complex, right? And it really needs to, Zach has I think this is on his list of things to make me do, to move this to the bottom of that discussion. So practical applications, that's where it's like, why, right? That's so dumb. Like, why do I care? Many indirections, whatever. Well, it turns out that there's a concept which I need to, Zach, make me do this too. There needs to be a section in here about, okay, is that, Jay, are you like, omniscient or exactly what? Because what I wanted to talk about next was jump tables. So I don't know. Jump tables. The idea is that sometimes I can create like a data structure and it's just full of pointers, right? And it can be, there's a bunch of reasons why that I, you know, situations in which I want to be able to store addresses, or even, for example, when you're doing, you know this more if you programmed more in C, which is pointers and pointers to pointers, right? You can have a variable that's a pointer, but I can send an address to that variable, right, of that variable into the function. So what I receive is the address of a variable that's outside, right? And that variable itself could be a pointer where I have to like do indirection and indirect, you know, do different levels of indirection. So the principle of indirection is a principle that occurs in, you know, low-level software a lot, operating systems and low-level assembly kinds of stuff. So you do, I don't want to get overly bogged down yet, but I do want to just say you do use it, okay? And it turns out to be really handy. Okay, we already did these. Okay, you ready for the example? Let's do it. I'm ready, okay? And I think I just want to do a quick double check.
What do you want me to remind you to do?
Talk about jump tables and like practical, maybe for all of these, act kind of a practical examples of where it would be handy to use these different addressing modes.
You know, I can think of a million right now.
I know. I just want to roll a couple in to the lectures. Okay. We'll do that. That's, and then the next generation of the students in this class will think that whatever, they'll think everything's great, and these guys will know that we're making it up as we go.
I know your secret.
Everybody already knows that about me, so it's good. All right, here's an example, okay? Ready? Here is some code. This is code. This is software, my friends. Believe it or not, this is frickin' software. It's just zeros and ones. How do we know it's software? Social contract. That's why we know it's software, because we have a social contract that says that over here in memory, right? Like, see right here, 30F6, right? Which has some bits, 16 of them. And there's the program counter, 30F6. That program counter points to this instruction. And that is why we know that that's software and not just ASCII values or pixels or data, rando data, or, you know, numbers in a spreadsheet, whatever, right? That's how we know. They might also be all those things, right? Because it's just like, what? How do you look at it? How do you look at it? It can be all the different ways. Okay, here we go. And I am, as always, when I've got the small print like this, I'm looking straight at my big screen that you see on the stream. So apologies for the side view. All right, registers just have random values. These guys up there, just zeros. Okay, but let's kick in. Are we ready? I know you are. The first instruction. Now, if you want to do this thing kind of live, follow along, you can pull up your own little opcode sheet, and this is where you start to get the practice. The first thing you do, very, very first thing you do, is just look at the opcode. 1110 and what is that? Anybody have that handy? I don't have my own handy, but I'm going to grab it. Let me see. I'll pull it up and kind of drag it over as kind of a cheat sheet helper thing right here.
Is it LEA?
Yes, it is. Right there, right? 1110, that's LEA. Okay, so that is load effective address. Now, what you would do also is you would go look in this document. If I can find it. There we go. There's LEA. And this will tell you what it's doing. Load effective address. So what this does, the operation is to take this PC offset, 9 bits of PC offset. Could be positive, could be negative. You sign extend it right there. And then I add it to the incremented program counter, whatever that is, and I put it into the destination register. That's it. I literally take the program counter, add this value, which will make it either smaller or bigger, and put that value into the destination register. And then I set the control codes. Remember the control codes? I set the control codes because I wrote a value to the register. So the control codes get set. That's it. And then if you want the verbal description right here, kind of a written description, you know, the address is computing by signed extending. It's really just what we just got done saying. And this is what it looks like if you do it in assembly language, which is the higher level, okay? With the semicolon is a comment, which kind of just tells you, you know, R4 gets the address of whatever target is. So with assembly language, you can actually use a label that you attach, which is what that is. And it's like, just takes the address of whatever target is and puts that in R4. So this is what it looks like in machine code right here. And the other is We'll talk later about why assembly is so cool in comparison. All right. So what I'm going to do is the destination register is going to be R1. We can see that. And the PC offset is this value right here, which is a negative number. You're like, okay, what negative number is it? Okay, cheat time, it's -3. You can kind of see that right there. But if you just conceptualize it, if you converted this to a positive number, you flipped all the bits, you would have all zeros, and then it would be 1, 0. You'd add 1, and you'd have all zeros, and then 1, 1, 3. So you know the value is -3. Okay? So I take the incremented program counter and I subtract 3 from it. Now, the incremented program counter, as soon as I grab that instruction, I increment the program counter. So the program counter actually points here to 30F7. Okay, that's the program counter. So -3 goes 1, 2, 3, and we're talking about this location. So load effective address should take the value 30F4 and it should put it into register 1, which is register 1's just up here. You know, currently it's 3, don't care. It's about to get slammed. So there we go. We take this value 30F4, and you see it 30F4. And that was that instruction. Boom. Programming. Programming in machine code. We're programming in ones and zeros, my friends. It's crazy. Isn't that crazy? Really?
It scares me.
I mean, you're like, we're programming the computer in ones and zeros. You know, back when I was a kid, that's all we had. And we didn't always have ones. And we were grateful. Okay. So, you know, with the Pharisee beard, I can do the cranky old grandpa way better. Huh. Get off my lawn. Get those kids off my lawn. All right. That guy was already incremented, right? Program counter was already incremented. Okay. So we're going to now pull this one. We fetch it. We go out, we grab it, we put it into the instruction register, we tease it apart. 0001, what do we got? What's the instruction for that one? I'm scanning back to my cheat sheet because I'm a cheater.
Add.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's the add instruction. Add instruction has a destination register, which is going to be register 2. Source register, register 1. Ooh, that's the one we just put in there. The 1 says immediate value, right? That bit 5, when it's a 1, it wants an immediate value, a 5-bit immediate value. And remember that that is a 2's complement number, so it could be positive, could be negative. Okay, this value happens to be positive 14, right? How can you tell? There's no ones. There's a 2, a 4, and an 8. 8 plus 4 is 12, plus 2 is 14. It's a positive number. Boom. So we take the contents of R1, we add 14 to it right here, and we put that value into R2. By the way, the program counter was incremented. All right. So R2 now has this R1 value with 14 added to it. Oh yeah. What is this thing doing? I have no idea. But we're gonna find out. Okay? Okay, the program counter already incremented. So we're now down here. We fetch it and we increment. Okay? So we're looking at 30F8, but the program counter already points us to 30F9. Oh, yeah. Opcode. First thing you always do, right? Look at the opcode. What's the opcode? 0011. And by the way, I said this already, but you get this cheat sheet in the exams, okay? We provide you the cheat sheet in the module exams when you, you know, for when you need them. Nobody should like be memorizing this would be like the dumbest possible thing to require of you. There are dumber things, but this would be one of them. Okay, 0011. Boom, that's a store, right? ST? Store takes a source register, and where's it going to put it? Into this PC offset 9. Okay? So let's take a look. It's going to take register 2, which we just morphed, and it's going to put it, this is a PC offset. It's a negative number. It is a negative number. Which one is it? What number is that? Anybody want to throw that out at me? You kind of can do this one in your head. It's a negative number, so you put the minus sign, but like, okay, what is it? What's the magnitude of it? Well, we got to negate it to find that out. So we flip all the bits. That gives me a 100. Then I have to add 1. That gives me 101, which is?
5.
Exactly, right? So it's negative 5. Now, which means that we are, the way store works is we're taking the contents of register 2 in this case, whatever we said the destination register was going to be, and we are going to put it into the location indicated by the program counter plus this PC offset, which happens to be a negative number. And in particular, negative 5. So the PC offset is already, the PC is already at 30F9. So let's go back 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? And so we're going to take the contents of R2 and we're going to put it right there. Okay? At that location. See how these are local variables? Do you see? Right? I mean, we're starting here at 30F6, but these two values here are kind of just local variables. You know, that's really kind of how we're using them. Okay. Let's fetch the next one. Right here. 0101. What do we got? Right on. That's an and. 0101. And add work exactly the same in terms of, you know, how they handle operands, right? So, all right. Destination register is 2. Source register is 2. And it's an immediate value because bit 5 says 1. And then what is the immediate value? 0. So we are going to take the contents of R2. We're going to AND it with the number 0, and then we're just going to put it right back in the same spot. What's going to happen? Right? Going to blow it up. You AND stuff with 0, you blow it up. It goes away. So let's do it. Exactly. There we go. Just did it. We just cleared that value, and R2 is now 0. Why did we do that? I don't know. Probably reasons. All right. Now we grab the next instruction from 30FA, which is like, we already looked that one up here, right? That's an add instruction again. Oh, and PC increments while we're looking at this. Destination is going to be 2. Source is going to be 2. So we're going to take the value 5 and we're going to add it to the contents of register 2. And then we're going to put it back into register 2. Boom. 5. And that's one way to put the number 5 into register 2. All right. Now we go grab the next one. That's all easy so far. There really isn't a ton of point to this. If you're like, okay, what did this program do? What are we doing? I don't know. It doesn't matter. What we are doing is giving some examples of using the different instructions, you know, in a kind of an interdependent kind of way. All right. Next one, 0111. We haven't seen that one before. 0111111111 is the STR. That's the one that uses the bass register and offset. Okay? And there's a source register. So let's take a look. So from register 2, that's the source of our the information that we're moving, the data we're moving. The bass register is register 1, and that means that over here in register 1, it probably better be an address. Well, it is no matter what, right? It's an address no matter how you slice it. Any 16 bits can be treated like an address. You just better hope that's what you were going for. Well, it turns out, if you remember, right, this is 30F4. 30F4, you know? So that actually does point to that location. Where are we at? That's the base register, but we have an offset. Yeah. So what's that offset? It's positive. Oh, it's four. It's 14 right there. Right? No ones. You got a 2, a 4, and an 8. No 16s. No 32s. Sorry, that was dumb. This is 2's complement. There is no 32's place. That's a sign bit. Okay, should we do it? We're going to take the contents of register 2, and we're going to store them into the location pointed to by R1 plus 14. And I think this is maybe like my dumbest slide, because it's off the picture. Because it's here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. It's down there. So it is kind of my dumbest animation. That's probably not strictly true. All right. And now we're at 30FC. The PC is going to be incremented. Ooh, see the little notation, by the way? This is, again, kind of notation that the book uses, that LC3 kind of uses, in order to give you some shorthand for everything, okay? Let's see. Opcode 1010. Where are we at? LDI. Load indirect. No. So we have the destination register. Where are we loading it into? And the PC offset. Seems super simple, right? But so we take the incremented program counter. And we take whatever this offset is, which happens to be, this is a little bit of shorthand right here, okay? Let's break this down. Take this value, 1111101111, and that's clearly a negative number. It's going to be an offset from wherever the incremented program counter is, which is 30FD, which is just outside of reach. And what's this number? It's negative. But what's the magnitude? Well, flip all the bits and add 1. Flip the bits, you get all zeros. 1, 0, 0, 0. You add 1, that gives you 1, 0, 0, 1. So I have a 1, no 2s, no 4s, and I have an 8. That's 9, right? 8 plus 1 is 9. So that value is negative 9. Now you got to start below. You got to start at 30FD, which is down off the screen. Actually, it's on the screen, but it's below the little memory thing. And let's go back 9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So once again, and you see it there encoded, 3F04. That's kind of shorthand for the PC incremented plus this offset, and you get 3F04. So it's shorthanding all of that. You go to this location, okay? And what's at that location? An address. You got to go to that address, 3102. You go there, get those contents, and drag it back. But that's the spot where we put that other thing that was off the charts that I said was dumb. So when I actually do this thing and I load R3, yeah, I just did it. Did I do it? Yeah, right there. There's R3, which is, that's our destination, right? Boom, R3. So we go out to the, so we go out to location 3102, grab that value, put it in R3. So that LDI has that double jump, okay? Is anybody else rung out? Tony Stark. I would have voted for Tony Stark, except
he's dead.
No. Spoilers. No, he's a fictional character. He's a comic book character.
I was close.
You're very close. He's not alive. That's true. Okay, but yeah, Stark would have gotten my vote, I think. Pretty sure. Okay. Everybody rung out a little bit by that, right? I mean, this is the... Okay, no, this is the thing. This is the tedium. This is what programming was originally. That's all you had. But this is also what programming is, always. At the fundamental level, at the bottom, you cannot, you know, really do well in, there's an advanced architecture class, right, in the CS track, and then a compiler class that follows it. You can't do well in those classes without an understanding. You're going to be revisiting this. The better you get it now, actually, the better it's going to be later on. It's not just like, oh crap, can we get through this so I can, you know, like I'm never going to use that again. Never again going to do, you know, double integrals on polar coordinates. You know, well, that might be true of calculus, but when you're in a computer science major, you know, this is a little bit more like, you know, fundamental ideas of algebra almost, you know what I mean, relative to calculus. Like, no, these are things that conceptually you will use them forever. In this field, not, and I don't just mean like twiddling bits, you know, directly, right? You're not typically not going to do that, but that guidance, yeah, polar, yeah, man. Thanks, Zach, for that. L'chaim. This is stuff that it never goes away. Conceptually, it never ever goes away. Okay. All right, control instructions, you ready? This is our last hurrah for this chapter. Chapter 5, lecture, which is module 6. Once again, can I just say, you got to be cranking, got to be cranking. I think most of you that are here live or listening, you know, on a quick schedule on YouTube and keeping up are, you know, you're not the ones I need to be talking to, but control instructions. This is all the branching and jumping stuff, okay? Here we go. The fundamental idea behind a control instruction is, hang on a second. Yeah, so let me see. Yeah, I didn't know what that meant, Jay. Here are the main opcodes. The ideas behind these opcodes for control instructions. Number one is the conditional branch. This is the part where we use the condition codes to be like, are we at zero yet? If so, we'll do this. Otherwise, we do that. That decision making, that ability to branch, has to be built into the computer, into the control unit. It has to be in that logic that it's gonna, you know, based upon. Whether a certain bit is on or not, take a branch or not. The unconditional jump, which we talked about, right? Which is just a straight up, here's the address, go. And then we've got the subroutine call, AKA the function call. That becomes really, really important for any kind of modular programming, right? The ability to write a little bit of code that's always going to work the same way. And you can like jump to it and jump back. And we'll talk about that. And then we've got these two, trap and return from interrupt. And trap is, it's a term you'll see in some processors. You don't always see it. That's not always the word. Sometimes they'll call it an interrupt. And it just depends on the architecture, okay? LC3 calls it a trap. And we'll get into that, and I'll break that down. This gets you, this starts to move you closer to sort of the system interface part of a computer, the part where that you can hook an operating system into so that you can actually, you know, run systems and keyboards and other kinds of stuff. There are these interrupt service routines, AKA trap routines, and return from interrupt is actually kind of subroutine. I really ought to add this as well. There's another one, which is there's a return from subroutine and a return from interrupt. And they both are just, you know, if you jump to someplace, there has to be a way of teleporting your way back, right? Or you just teleport away and you can never get back. That's the idea. The first two are where we're going to focus right now, okay? Okay, let's talk about the conditional branch instruction. Okay. So, remember, a couple things to remember. One is that GPR is, just for shorthand here, general purpose register, okay? That just means one of those eight registers, 0 through 7, that we've been talking about. And let's just say that the last value loaded into a GPR, stored into a GPR, written into a general purpose register, was a 0, okay? Now what that means is that in the control codes, the N bit is 0, and the P bit is 0, and the Z bit is on. Remember that the control codes, there's always one of them is on and the other two are off. Always, 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 okay? So the 0 condition code, right, in the LC3 is 1. The current instruction address, we're just going to go, this is just a hypothetical. We're just setting it up. Let's say that the current instruction is 4027. So the PC is one past that, 4028. All right? And let's see. So let's drop down here. So all zeros, let's bring it on back. Where are we at? All zeros. That's the branch instruction. Okay? Cool, cool. Oh, and just to remind ourselves, this next thing, okay, there's a tricky thing I'm going to tell you about that involves CNZP right here, and then there's a PC offset 9. I want to talk about this NZP. This is really, really important, and I think I have a picture. Let me just double check. Yeah. I got a picture coming up. But you're going to like totally just gag and puke all over the branching if you don't understand this thing I am about to reveal to you, which is that this NZP relates to the control codes, but they are not the control codes. Okay? They relate to them. Remember masks? Remember bit masks that we talked about? They're back. This basically says, which of the control codes do I care about? Which of the control codes do I want to look at? Okay? I'm basically saying, I don't want to look at zero, at the N bit. I don't want to look at the P bit. I only want to look at the Z bit. And then what happens is, I'm saying, if the Z bit is set in the control codes, then take the branch. If it's not, no branch. Just keep going. Program counter, next program counter instruction. Okay? And when I take the branch, it's to this spot right here, which is a PC offset 9. So that's a positive number. So it's right here. That's actually 0D9. So what I do is, the last value that was written was 0, which means that the Z bit in the condition codes is set to 1. Down here, I'm just like, yeah, that's the one I'm looking at. I don't care about the others. Okay? Therefore, when I get to this instruction, since the Z bit is on and that's the one I said to look at, I'm going to take the incremented program counter, 4028. I'm going to add to it the offset that's in here, which is 00D9. I'm going to get 4101 as my result. And I'm just going to take that value and just put it into the program counter. And by I'm going to, I mean the control unit is going to take that value, stick it in the program counter. And then it's going to go, all right, we're all good. Ready? Go, program counter. And it's going to go down to location 4101, grab the instruction. What did I just do? I just teleported. Right? Program counter is fetching the next instruction. How do I make him jump? By just suddenly in the middle, he fetched. You're like, hey, I got another number for you, number 7. And he's like, oh, you're right here, 7. And now he's running here and he's incrementing. Oh, there's another one. It's F275, you know, and then on his next grab, he grabs from down there. He's jumping all over the place. And all we're doing is just writing a different value into the program counter. Isn't that cool? I think that's kind of like, that's the sound it makes in my head. Okay, you ready? This is what's so important, okay? You got to believe me. You have to believe me. Here's my program counter, right? Right there. Now, this would be cool to animate, but I don't have it animated. Apologies. I'm going to blame Zach.
Remember that talk we had?
You being a big guy who has your address now.
It's true. That's true. But for all you know, I gave you an indirect address. So that when you get there, there's actually just, you know, it's not the right place, but they'll tell you how to get there. You don't know. You don't know. Okay. So here's the program counter right here. And already incremented. Are we incremented? Yeah, we got to be incremented. Okay, the last instruction written to a register, the last value written to a register was 0. So notice that that over here, this is hardware. Okay, this is circuitry right here. That's the N bit, the Z bit, and the P bit. These are 1-bit registers. They're 1-bit memory. Yes, a gated D latch housing a happy little RS latch. 1 bit's worth. And again, for these guys right here, one of them is always on and the other two are always off. Always, always, always. Because this is hardware. Because these are the only 3 possibilities when you look at what happened when a value was written to a register. Okay, now what this does is it basically pulls our little bits, okay, the little NZP bits, and it kind of goes, I'm basically going to use it like a bit mask, so that like the 0 on the N bit means that I'm dropping a 0 in here. Do I have it? Zach, you got to make me animate this, Zach. You have to make me.
Dang it, Zach.
Damn it, Zach. Make Dr. K do this thing. So that becomes a mask and goes into the AND gate, right? This Z is a 1, which means it's putting a 1 into the AND gate, which means whatever Z is going to pass on through. The P, it's a 0. Now, here's what I don't like about this graphic and why I need to do other graphics and animate this bad boy, is because the problem is these are called NZP, those are called NZP, and they're not the same. And then you see the angst, you see the tension, and this is 0, 1, and 0, and these are 0, 1, and 0, and they're not the same, okay? Now, here's how I'm going to illustrate it. Now, what's going to happen here, of course, is that the 1 and the 1 here on the Z are going to pass on through. It's going to say yes, all right? Which is going to cause this PC offset that gets added to the program counter, right? That's going to be the thing that says that's what gets loaded into the PC. It is the value we talked about over here, 4028, 4028 plus D9. It's that value that's going to go into the program counter. Now, this part has to be interactive, okay? So hang with me here. What would happen? What would happen if I had this NZP bit in my instruction, all zeros? Because I could do that. This is Zach where we gotta build another slide. You know what I mean? To articulate this difference. A couple of other ones. But this is one of them. They're all zero. What happens? Let's say I'm going to wait for Bueller or anybody else.
If all of them are zero, you're not going to jump, are you?
Nope. No way I can, right? I can't jump. No matter what Van Halen says, I am not going to jump. Right, because it's zero, 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 which means I'm dropping a zero into this AND gate, a zero into this AND gate, and a zero into this AND gate. Nothing, you know, it's going to come out no. At the bottom, it's going to say, no, don't take the jump. No matter what, no matter which of these bits is set. Now, here's the thing. There are 8 different possible combinations that I can embed into my instruction, right? Everywhere from 00 to 111. Because all I'm saying is what the mask looks like. But over here in the actual hardware registers, there are literally only 3 combinations. The N is on and the others are off. The Z is on, the others are off. Or the P is on and the others are off. So the actual hardware can only be one of 3 things, but I can look at those 3 things 8 different ways. Okay? So, okay, why in the crap would I, you know, why would I have 000 on the NZP. Why would I want to do that? I'm going to give you a hint in the chat. It's not much of a hint. There you go, Zach. Yeah. No op. I feel like suddenly with me and Zach and Morgan that we were like the knights who say nop. The knights who say nop demand a sacrifice.
A shrubbery.
Anyway, so let's talk about it. If this whole thing was zero, what would happen? If the thing was just all zeros. Right? If it was all zeros, what would happen? Anybody? Bueller? Okay, I'll give you a hint. Nothing would happen. The program counter, you would fetch it. You would decode it. You would see that it was a branch instruction. You would check the 000. You would take no branch. And you would increment the program counter and keep going. They call it a no-op. It's actually an instruction. It's called a no-op, meaning no operation. The only reason to put no ops in, there's a couple reasons. One is, if you're trying to do a timing loop and you want it to burn a little bit of time, you can put in a bunch of no ops, like just loop a bunch of no ops and do nothing. That's one thing you can do. Also, sometimes you just have a bunch of no ops. It's like code's going to come here later and we're going to patch the binary later. For now, I'm just going to put a bunch of zeros. When the code gets to that part, it goes, do nothing, do nothing, do nothing, and then it just keeps going. Later on, I can actually drop code in there without hurting anything. Crazy, right? That's a little weird, but I can actually, and that is sometimes referred to as patching the binary, a binary patch, where I'm actually changing the binary code. Okay, what about this one? What about 111? What if I did 111? What would that do? What do you think? I mean, what do you know? Look at it and what do you know?
It would jump, right?
Yep. When would it jump? I mean, under what condition would it jump?
Always.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right? Ever, always, always, always. So if it was 111, because look, one of the three is going to be on. And if I say 111, guess what? It's always going to jump. Okay? It's always going to take the jump. So that's one way to do like an absolute jump, right? When I get to here, like you're going to do a loop, right? Sometimes you check the condition. Do I keep going or not? If I'm not, you know, and whatever, and you go to the bottom and you like always like jump back to the top to check your condition or whatever. There are situations where you always take the jump, just like a regular jump instruction, but that's like using a branch as a jump. And you're limited though to PC offset 9. So you are limited to how far you can jump. Why would you do something like N and Z are on, but P is off? Or let's go N and P are both on and Z is off. Right? Why would you do stuff like that? What would that do for you?
Maybe for like greater than zero or greater than equals zero.
Right, right. I mean, greater than zero would be a positive number, right? So P would be on and Z and N would be off. But if you wanted to do greater than or equal to zero, right? Then I would want to have the P and the Z on, but the N is off, right? Or it could be a non-zero number, any number that's non-zero. So if N or P are both on, right? But I don't care about zero, make zero, you know, give that guy zero. Then it's like, that's a non-zero value. So you're really looking at, it's like, you know, it's negative, it's zero, it's positive, that's obvious. It's non-zero, that's one combination of two, right? It's just that it's non-zero. Another one is that it's less than or equal to zero. It's greater than or equal to zero. What am I missing? I feel like I'm missing something. There's the universal, which is all of them are on. Oh, and then the eighth one is never jump and always jump. And then those are the other six conditions, right? I'm you know, one of the three or one of the other combinations of two. This is my impersonation of the other combinations of two. Okay, but this is key. This is so key. To understand this, you've got to separate in your head that these three bits, which are the same three bits here, in the instructions, those three bits are a mask to tell you what to look at among the three physical registers. They just happen to all be called NZP. I'd like to apologize to everybody for that. Okay. I don't want to do this. We have to. We have no choice. I want to go You know, it's nights like tonight that I wish that I was a drinker. Oh, whoo. Okay, where are we at here?
A little nip to take the edge off.
A little, yeah, exactly. A little something to take the edge off. Instead, I'm going to like probably pop some popcorn, maybe work on a puzzle or something. I don't know. Or just watch some, you know, post-apocalyptic, you know, sci-fi. Go watch
CNN. You mean the news?
Like CNN, exactly. Oh yeah, exactly. That was good. Thank you. Thank you for that.
You're
moment.
Welcome.
That was a highlight reel for me right there. Like CNN. I mean, not, and again, if anybody's like really team red, you know, on CNN. By which I mean logo color and not party color. You know, then I, you know, apologize.
I thought we were just talking about the post-apocalypse part.
Right. I mean, insert whatever, you know what I mean? Insert your favorite whatever. Everybody sucks.
And again, Fox is just a different post-apocalyptic.
No, exactly right. As is MSNBC. And everybody's got their own little post-apocalyptic flavor. Okay, friends, let's do this thing. We're going to do like a real one. We're going to do a real one. I don't want to do this, honestly. I don't even want to be here right now. Let me be really honest. But we have to. We have to. Oh, and by the way, again, reminder, I am on set on Thursday at the normal time. I sent an announcement. Did I send an announcement? If I didn't, I was going to. I may not have.
You know now.
But you know now, and I will send an announcement, that we're going to do a replacement class on Wednesday, get it ahead of time. So Thursday's class will be on Wednesday, same time. And again, for everybody who normally is like, I can't do that. I, you know, well, okay, good. Show up on Thursday. I won't be here. Watch the video on YouTube. Ta-da. And I'll be off. Winning myself an Emmy or something. I don't know what I'm going to be doing. I don't think extras can earn Emmys. That'd be awesome though if you could. Okay. So here's the deal. Here's the deal. Here's our setup and what we're going to try to do. And we're going to introduce you to this idea here. Of, I guess, what do we call these things? Flow charts, I guess. There's an ancient thing here called the flow chart. Now, flow charts are dumb and worthless, my view, from a programming perspective, unless you're programming in assembly language, because any notation has to be like a higher level of abstraction than the thing you're using to actually encode it. Okay, so that's helpful here because it's like set it up, make a decision. You know, is R2 down to zero yet? Make a decision. If it is, go there. If it's not, do this and go back up here, right? That's useful as a high-level abstraction. But if you wrote a couple lines of Python code to do the whole thing, you know, set up, you know, or you just did like a for loop, whatever, You don't need a flow chart. Your high level code is already kind of a flow chart. You know what I mean? You don't need to. It's redundant when you're programming in high level languages to use flow charts, in my opinion. And you can trust me because I'm a doctor. Here's what we're doing. There are 12 consecutive memory locations that we just put integers into. I don't care what they are. Right? We don't care. They're just know that they're integers. Which, guess what? Okay, here's the dirty little secret. They always are integers, right? I mean, I can already just assume they're integers, whatever. Treat them like integers. It's all good. And the addresses are 3100 to 310B. If you run the numbers at home, you'll see that that's 12 different values, right? From 0 to B. B is the hex value for 11. 0 to 11, that's 12. Okay, could you do this thing? Let's real quick. Can you do that without looping? I mean, this sets up. Obviously, I'm going to talk about a loop. But could you do it without looping? Could you? Could you? Huh? What do you think? Can you do it without looping, and how would you do it? No, even if the value is not zero, Jay. What say you? I'm waiting. Waiting impatiently. Talk to me.
Can't, you're scary.
Okay, am I intimidating everybody? Answer me! Now! Can you do it without looping? I want to add them. I want to compute the sums. Come on. I'm not relenting on this. I'm staying here. I got all day.
Okay, what was the question again?
There was no question. No, actually, Mike, so the question is, why is everybody so shy? That's the question. Can you do this thing, 12 locations in memory, and I want to compute the sums of those 12 locations with in assembly, you know, in machine language. Can I do it without looping?
Do we have any extra locations that we could be storing our sum in? Like,
oh yeah, always. Yeah. That's not part of the, yeah, the only real question is loops or no loops. You know, you've got to be storing the sum. You've got to be like, you know,
you could do it as one consecutive long thing, right?
Yeah. Right. What would that look like, Michael?
Just the value of 3100 plus 31021 and so on to,
yeah,
B.
Yeah. That's right. You would hard code. You would just hard code and say, okay, go to location 3100, load that value into a register, right? Have some register that was like the sum, you know, the running total. Start it with zero. And they'd be like, load the value at 3100. And then, I mean, your code would just go, brrr, it would be long, right? Load the value into 3100. Sorry. The value that's in location 3100 into a register, add that to the running total, you know, and store that back on the running total. And now hard code. Grab the value at 3101. You would just keep going one after another. You don't have to loop to do it. In fact, in some compiler optimization, they actually refer to that as loop unrolling, where the compiler, you know, under certain circumstances, it can be way more efficient and faster, depending upon whether you're optimizing to speed or memory, you know, space. There's usually a trade-off between time and space when it comes to optimizing software, optimizing code, right? If you think about it, right? If I've got a lot of room, I can lay stuff out, and, you know, if I got a small amount of room, I got to do a lot more steps, you know, play the shell game to get everything where I need it. So the number one reason I would not do it is if it was just a couple things or, you know, whatever, where the work of doing the loop is more pain than just doing the, you know, like if n were 2, you know, if I were going to do this twice, making a loop to do it twice, you know, maybe that's not smart. 3 times maybe even, right? Because I've got this overhead to do all the checking and branching and setting it all up. Sometimes I just hard code it. But if the value is like 1,000, you're going to do this 1,000 times. You don't want like 1,000 different hard coded instructions. That would be, so, well, same reason if you have like an array, right? If you wanted to add all, if you had an array of integers, right? And you had like an index into the array, you could literally take array sub 1 plus array sub 2 plus array sub 3 plus array sub 4, right? Isn't that all we're doing? And when the compiler was done doing its thing, it would look like exactly what we're talking about. Load, go out to memory, grab the thing, load it in a register, add it together, put it in the register, go to the next one. And that's what, if we were writing this in Python or something, you know, or C++ or C#, it might be like, array sub 1 plus array sub 2 plus array sub 3 plus array sub 4, you know, all hard-coded. And that's how we would do it in a high-level language. Okay, but here's what we're going to do. We are going to take the value of, we're going to, okay, so number one, we're going to put the value 3100 into R1. We're putting the address of the first location. Okay? We're going to clear R3, make him zero. And we're going to clear R3 because that's going to be our running total. We got to clear R3. And we're going to do this 12 times. So we need R2, we're going to use as a counter. We'll set him up to be 12, and we're going to count it down till it gets to zero. Right? When we get to zero, we're done. Somebody start to see and feel how the control codes can play in here. Right? If I've got R2 and I just keep decrementing it, right? At some point when I decrement R2 and put that value back into R2, when it's zero, the Z bit's going to get set. And that's going to be our trigger. Boom, that's when we jump out. So having set it up like this, we're going to ask ourselves a question. Is R2 to zero yet? If it is, we kick out. In other words, we take the branch. But otherwise, we don't take the branch. We just fall right through. Take the next incremented program counter. We then go out to memory, pointed to by R1. Okay? That is going to remind you of the LDR instruction where you've got that register, right? And we're going to go out to memory. We're going to put that value into R4. We're going to add R4 and R3. R3 is the running total. And put that value back into R3. So we're just go out to memory, grab the value, put it in R4, add R4 to the total, and then store that value back in the total to R3. We're going to increment R1. So now R1 was looking at this spot in memory. Now R1 is looking at this spot in memory. So R1 is going to move through memory. We just keep changing the register. Okay? And then we're going to decrement R2 so that it's our little countdown. So you've kind of got four, you're using four registers for this idea. Okay? R1 is always the address of what you're pointing to. R2 is the countdown. R3 is the running total, and R4 is the value you pulled out of memory to add, you know, the integer you pulled out of memory in order to add with everything. Oh, and then when you're done with that decrement, you got a hard jump. You got an unconditional jump your way back up here. Okay? Is everybody tracking on that? I hope so. How are we doing? We're also running almost out of time. I'm going to finish this example, and then we'll cut. Maybe not. Maybe we won't. Hang on a second. I want to see how. No, you know what? You know what? This is not all Mondo animated like the other one. I think it's just because it's just too much. What do we do? What do we do? I can roll through this. We'll definitely finish tomorrow. For sure, for sure. I'm going to do this real quick, but it'll be fast, okay? And you'll have to look back at it yourself. Does that sound good? And then I know if some of you, Morgan's out, and Mark Cuban, both out. What do you think? What do you think? Should I do that now, or should I? I mean, because some of you got other class, you know, at 2:30. What say you? We already agreed that I don't know whether I'm going to be more, you know. Yeah, so Jacob said leave it for next time. Yeah, I'm good with that. I'm good with that. And then what we can do is come back to this one with the adding integers, you know, this graphic. Start here. And then we will have, there's only another like 8 slides after this, you know. And we'll just show you a couple different things. We're going to like quickly introduce you to jump and trap, but just kind of, you know, a lot more quickly. Okay. Let's call it. I say we call it. So, you know, watching the video on Thursday or tomorrow night or, you know, whatever works. But at least, you know, on Thursday. Again, I'm supposed to be on set, so I think it'll work if I do that tomorrow. If we take care of that. So anyone who can make it tomorrow at 1 o'clock would be great. So, all right, gentle friends. I need something to take us out. We got to have something to take us out. Let's do a little Foo Fighters. Or as Christopher Walken would say, Foo Fighters. And this is one of my favorite Foo Fighters tunes called Next Year, right? Which includes the incredible lyric, watching the wide world riot and hanging out and hiding out. Watching the wide world riot and hang and hiding out. I'll be coming home next year. Yeah. All right. See you, everybody.